Hi folks, I just want to talk about apologetics, and just to give you my own thoughts about apologetics and the influences on me and how I use the apologetics and in what context, and I hope that my thoughts will be a help and a blessing to you. If you turn to 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 15, it says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts." But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. So it's already, it says, but be always ready to give an answer to every man. So there is the mandate, really, for apologetics. Apologetics is like a defense of the faith. It's answering questions. And I just want to talk about apologetics, its right place, and where it can be helpful, etc. Especially in the area of street evangelism. A lot of street preachers are against apologetics on the streets. And the argument is we just preach the gospel and we're not there to answer people's questions. First of all, I would say that our job as preachers, when we go out on the streets and doing evangelism and as evangelists, our job is to preach the gospel. We're ambassadors and we're to proclaim the gospel, the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ, his life, death and resurrection. That's what we're there to do, preach that. Secondly, Paul talks about we go in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. We cannot do it in our own strength. We have to depend on the Holy Spirit. So these are foundational truths. We also believe that the carnal mind cannot see the spiritual things. That only unless the Holy Spirit opens their mind can they see the truth. Now these are fundamental, basic truths. And they are at the center of any person who wants to be a preacher or an evangelist on the streets. So that goes without saying. So, answering people's questions and giving answers for the faith should not become above depending on the Holy Spirit. It should not be above the gospel. It's the gospel being proclaimed. It is dependent on the Holy Spirit. But, apologetics, answering questions, is helpful to clear the way, to help proclaim the gospel, to help the Holy Spirit to work in that situation. It is an aid to help people come to faith. And so that's what it says here. The sanctify the Lord God in 1 Peter 3:15. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer in every man that asketh you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. In my own experience, I found that when doing street preaching, a lot of people feel and think that street preachers are anti-intellectual, that they don't think, that they really just don't answer any questions and they really don't know what they're talking about. A lot of people on the streets feel that towards street preachers and evangelists. I found a good reception, especially in amongst university students, being able to answer questions. Because I read about Islam, I read philosophy, I read about other religions, I read about science. When people ask me questions, I'm able to answer some questions and help people with those questions. A lot of people appreciate it. Now, you can get people who will take you down rabbit trails. A lot of people, you can be debating a Muslim or you can be debating somebody and or talking to somebody and they're just trying to take you down a rabbit trail. And that can happen quite a lot. And that's not healthy and that's not good. But on the other hand, you do meet a lot of people who are sincere and they have sincere questions. And they really appreciate it if you've taken the time to A, listen to them, and B, you've got a decent response. Then they're more willing to listen to the gospel. So that's where I found apologetics helpful. I found it that when it comes to meeting that person who really has genuine questions, apologetics is helpful to clear the ground so that you can share the gospel and allow the Holy Spirit to work. Some people can go over the top and they make apologetics so big that they're not really dependent on the Holy Spirit, they're not preaching the gospel, and they've been taken down rabbit trails, and that's no good. Paul says we preach Christ crucified. We're to preach the cross, we're to stay focused on the cross. But as we stay focused on the cross and as we depend on the Holy Spirit, it's not wrong, and it can be helpful to be able to have up your sleeve questions answered, that you've studied and you've looked at things and you can answer questions. It's very, very helpful on the streets. The danger is if you become over-intellectual, you don't depend on the Holy Spirit and you're not proclaiming the truth. That's dangerous. But if you proclaim the gospel central and you depend on the Holy Spirit, but under your sleeve you're able to have a few answers to questions, it will serve you in good stead, and it will help you to get a hearing for the gospel. So those are my thoughts. So that's just a basic thought about apologetics. My own apologetic method, my own apologetic style, is I don't get stuck on one method. I use a variety of methods. I use an eclectic mix of apologetic styles and methods. So there are a number of methods out there. For example, there is presuppositionalism, which deals, advocated by Van Til, who's a theologian dead now, and Greg Banson, and some theologians today like John Frame. So presuppositionalism seeks to look at people's foundational beliefs that they have no evidence for. So for example, an atheist has a foundational belief that reality is real. So a presuppositionalist will look at that foundation and say, look, have you got any reasons for this foundation being rational? How do you know that your brain is not in a make-believe world if there is no God? So presuppositionalism goes for the foundations. Presuppositionalism is very, very philosophically sophisticated. It's very, very helpful, especially amongst hard-hitting groups. It's very helpful when you come against atheists and Muslims. It's a very good method to deal with very hard-hitting groups. Often the atheists will hit you with saying there are problems with the Bible, slavery and all the rest of it. The Muslims will hit you saying the Bible's changed. So having a presuppositional apologetic style and method is very, very helpful in dealing with very, very tough questions. It's a very robust apologetic. But I don't subscribe just to presuppositionalism. I also use evidentialism, which might seem a contradiction, but it's not. Francis Schaeffer used a variety of apologetic methods. He was a great apologist. But I use evidentialism. One of them, evidential method, is the minimal fact arguments for the resurrection. Advocated by Gary Habermas and Mike Lacona. That methodology that I've pretty much mastered the basic arguments and evidences for that methodology. And there are certain basic minimal facts that we can use using basically Western scholarship on the historical Jesus, and gives us evidence for the resurrection. So that's another method that's very powerful and very helpful. There's also basic arguments, like the fine-tune argument, which is advocated by William Lane Craig, and the Kalam argument. These are very effective and very helpful. So that's another method of style of argument. So what I do is I take a variety of apologetic methods. I learn from certain different apologists. I take something from James White, I take something from David Wood, I take something from Jeff Durbin, and I use whatever fits and is helpful for me. And so I would encourage you to use a more eclectic, don't tie yourself down to one methodology, but I've you know, tried to bring it all together. That this is my view anyway. So I have a mixture of presuppositionalism, evidentialism, and other apologetic styles and methods. There's certain apologists home in and specialise in certain things. James White specialises in debating Jehovah's Witnesses, debating Catholics, debating atheists, and debating Muslims. David Wood, principally atheists and Muslims. So every apologist has their strengths and weaknesses. So just take from the strengths, etc. The other thing I do is I go to apologetic websites and I try to do as much study as I can. So for example, if I'm debating Muslims or wanting to reach out to Muslims, I spend a lot of time on Answering Islam. If I want general information, I go on to Christian Think Tank, Tectonic Apologetics, Apologetics 315, I think it is, Apologetic Press, Ravi Zachariah Ministries, C.S. Lewis Ministries, Discovery Institute, William Lane Craig's site, Mike Lacona's site, Gary Habermas's site. Look at old videos, old debates, such as Greg Banson's debates. Sometimes go on Reformed podcasts at Westminster Theological Seminary. Sometimes I'll listen to Bible scholars, Bible teachers, such as Al Muller on issues. Sometimes I'll look at specialist scholars. So for example, on textual criticism, I'll look at Wallace, Block, and Peter Williams, etc. So this is how I deal with apologetics. So if I'm thinking about textual criticism, I go to certain scholars, certain sites. If I'm thinking about a certain kind of argument that I want to grow and develop a bit more, there's certain people that I know I can go to. If you want to find out where I'm at, my resources, the things that I use, if you go on to jasonburnspreacher.com, you'll see some links to apologetic sites that I advocate that I think are helpful, and you can go and look at them. There's also hundreds and hundreds of apologetic videos of me dotting about the website that you can find. So have a look, you'll be able to find some helpful apologetic material from the Bible and slavery to morality, etc. There's also a few debates here and there with Muslims and atheists that you can look at. Having a bit of knowledge about logic, about logical fallacies, is very helpful on street apologetics. And I would encourage you to go and learn some logical fallacies. There's a guy called Jason Lyle, who was a physicist turned apologist, and he's done a good few videos on logical fallacies, and they're very helpful because you can spot the fallacies and you can point it out in your discussion with people on the streets, and that I found that very, very helpful in discussing with people. So those are my thoughts on apologetics. I'll just say some of the people, some of the apologists that have been helpful to me, and resources. Bart Ehrman Project has been very helpful in giving information about textual criticism and the defense of the Bible. Has been very helpful. Peter Williams, on the historical Jesus has been very helpful. Matt Slick's Calm Apologetics is very helpful when looking about the Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, and atheism, especially atheism. And Jeff Durbin is very helpful when it comes to looking at Mormonism and atheism. I found those guys very, very helpful. When it comes to dealing with Islamic apologetics and apologetics to Islam, I found David Wood, Sam Shimon, the most useful and most helpful in dealing with Muslims. I found James White helpful, but not as helpful as those guys. Jay Smith is very helpful, but again, I found Simone and David were very hard-hitting, and I like that. They give you some really hard-hitting material that you can really challenge Muslims on. I think that... I think the thing that you have to be aware as well is that the Christian apologists, it's all polite and it's all nice online in their universities and etc. But when you're in real life on the streets, it can be quite tough. And so you need to pray that God will give you a determination and that He will help you to be strong. You got to be ready for real pushback when you're on the streets. You know, people are not just going to take easy answers or easy sound bites. So you've got to really be ready to be strong in your faith and really ready to stand up for the truth and not to be put down or pushed down. So there's a big difference there when you're studying apologetics as to actually the way it plays out in real life. I think also a couple of things as well, is to pray to have love. You know, at the end of the day, you can win an argument but lose the man or lose the woman. So you need to pray that as people ask questions and you answer them, that, you know, you're leading them to Jesus, you're depending on the Holy Spirit, but also that you really love them, that you really care about them. It's no good winning arguments. We're trying to win souls. So pray that you have the love for people. And then the next thing I would say is, there's another thought, really. Yeah, your demeanour, your character should be amicable and nice. You know, very often, you know, only a few days ago I was somewhere in Chester and I was talking to two Mormon girls. They were really, really nice people and I was talking to them. And they were open to listen to the gospel. And a guy, supposedly an evangelical, just came along and butted in the conversation. It was very rude. And started going on at these Mormons, really, really aggressive. And I thought to myself, well, even if you've got the truth, you're losing these girls because your attitude, it just stinks. You're not showing them any love. And so I think that, you know, when you're talking to people, talk to them with respect, listen to them. And if you listen to them and you respect them, you know, they'll listen to you and respect what you have to say. So treat them with grace, treat them with the kindness that you would want to be treated when you're actually talking. I've learned this over a number of years where I failed. You know, and especially online, you've got a big responsibility. I've made mistakes online where I've gone in the flesh. And you've got to be careful that whether you're online or whether you're in real life on the streets, you're a representative of Christ. And so be careful. You know, I'll just say as well that, you know, if you're going to go online, making YouTube comments or talking to people on Facebook or wherever you go on social media sites to share the gospel and debate people and whatever, that when you go there, you know, you need to pray about whether God wants you there. Why are you there? What is the reason? Sometimes we can get lonely, sometimes we can get down, sometimes we're not at the best. And just surfing on the social media, it's just an easy way of passing time and you can meet new people there and stuff like that, but it cannot be healthy. Maybe you just need to get out and meet people rather than being on social media. I'm speaking to someone who's made a big mistake in the past in looking to social media as a way of helping you emotionally, but it's not a good thing. You know, you need healthy relationships where you're meeting people, where you're working with people, where you're doing valuable stuff. So be careful you don't get on the social media in a bad habit. You know, make sure you're accountable. Make sure that you have a reason and a purpose for why you're going in a set time. And, you know, keep tabs on yourself and don't get too hooked on social media in that sense. And especially when it comes to saying things, emotions can run away and you can say things that are not really edifying, not helpful, and then you regret it. Or even make videos or whatever that you know that are not up to scratch, that they're not representative of what really you like. So just be careful, pray about things before you actually get involved. I'm speaking as someone who made a lot of mistakes in the past concerning that. So, yeah, so you're apologetic. Is on the streets, but if you do it social media, that's a different ball game, and you need to really, really be careful the way you conduct yourself on social media. Because once you put it down there, it's there, and you can't get rid of it. Even if you try to, someone somewhere will have preserved it, and so you've got to be very, very careful. So those are my thoughts, and I hope that's a blessing to you. Hope that's an encouragement to you, and just a bit of advice, a bit of encouragement. So I want to maybe just recommend a couple of books that I've found helpful. And a couple of things specifically that I found helpful. I found Greg Benson's articles and his debates and lectures, very helpful in apologetics, very, very helpful, very powerful stuff. I don't agree with everything Greg Benson says. I don't agree with his reconstructionism to a point. It's a bit unbalanced. But when it comes to apologetics, when it comes to defending the faith, he is the man. He really is a powerful apologetic, and I would encourage you to get a hold of Greg Benson's books, get a hold of his debates and listen to them, and his lectures. They will really equip you as an apologist and to do apologetics. And the other thing, in terms of books, I think that a resource that I found very, very helpful is Mike Lacona's The Resurrection of Jesus. It's a large book, it's by IVP, but I found that book very, very helpful, and is a good resource. And then I think that a very helpful resource to go to is The Unbelievable Radio Show. The Unbelievable Radio Show, where there are scholars that go on like Richard Baucom, Dr. Crosley, Bart Ehrman, and they debate each other, and they're very helpful discussion. And so those are a couple of things that you could look at if you want to get into apologetics. There's also a website called Apologetics 101, Presuppositionalism 101. That's a very good site if you want to really start to think through apologetics. If you want to think through your methodology, you might become a presuppositionalist in your apologetic method. You might become an evidentialist, but to find out where you are on the spectrum, go and read and study on Presuppositionalism 101 is a very helpful site to maybe work out where you're at, what you think about these things. So, an apologist that has had a big impact on me, I think the apologists that have had the biggest impact on me are Francis Schaeffer, Greg Banser. And I think Jay Smith, William Wayne Craig, Mike Lacona, Gary Habermas, James White, and Sam Shimon, Ravi Zachariah, Peter Williams, John Lennox. I don't agree with some of them. Some of them are theistic evolutionists, which I disagree totally. I do not agree with that. So I don't necessarily agree with some of them theologically. But you can, they've had a big impact because I've learned quite a bit from them in different other ways. In your apologetics, just one last thing. In your apologetics, and Matt Slick is another guy who's influenced me quite a bit. In your apologetics, you need to know where you stand theologically. What your theology is will shape your apologetics. So, I'm from Reformed background, so Reformed theology. Reformed theology informs my apologetic method. So, another good apologist as well is Give Me an Answer, which I've learned quite a lot from the guy on there. But your theology will have a big impact on the way you do apologetics, how you see apologetics. So you need to find out where you stand theologically, what your theology is, what your Bible teaching is. If you go on my website, jasonbirdspreacher.com, you'll find out where I am at and you'll find out resources. What's his name? Someone who is completely different theologically than me, thinks in a different way from me on street preaching is Jesse Morrell. If you wanted to see somebody of a different theological mindset, does things in a different way, go and have a look at Jesse Morrell. If you want to find out where I'm at theologically, go to jasonbirdspreacher.com. So I hope that's been a help to you. God bless you and have a lovely day. Take care.